very really excellent panel here to discuss India Southeast Asia security cooperation here in over the next hour or so. We have two participants from India. Your biographies are included in the conference pack, so you can read it at your leisure. Darshana Baruah from Carnegie, India, and Admiral Anup Singh, who was recently retired from the Indian Navy. But we are also particularly privileged to have two excellent speakers from Southeast Asia. To my far right, Rommel, who is from the Philippines, and who is a very close monitor of all things in the South China Sea. He can show you images and stuff if you wanted to. But also works on counterterrorism as well, right? And particularly in the southern Philippines. And then to my far left is Collin from Singapore. He's with the Rajaratnam School of International Studies at Nanyang Technological University. And he has done some very interesting work on maritime security in particular, including in the Indian Ocean. He received a PhD from RSIS. So that's a nice reminder to all of us to turn our phones off. I'm going to do the same. I'm just trying as well. But without further ado, let me turn it over to Darshana, who will begin the panel by talking about the state of India's security cooperation with Southeast Asia. So without further ado, over to you. Thank you.
Thank you, Dhruva. Thank you, Brookings, for inviting me to this conference and being privileged to be part of this panel. I can actually see some people in the audience who probably mentored me at some point, so it's really privileged to be speaking. Asian multilateralism and new defense security configurations. I didn't exactly want to list out the exercises or the arrangements we have with ASEAN or Southeast Asia right now. So what I've done is we've been through how India is engaged with Southeast Asia and what is it doing now. So as you all probably aware, India began an ambitious policy of Lockheed in the early 90s and stepped up to its cooperation and presence in Southeast Asia. Over the years, India's relationship with ASEAN grew and became stronger from dialogue partner to strategic partner, participation in East Asia Forum to ADMM Plus. I think Yashil Sinha in 2013 had captured the India-ASEAN and the relationship in his Lucas policy, saying the first phase of India's Lucas policy was ASEAN-centered and focused primarily on trade and investment linkages. Then we moved into a second phase from the early 2000s, which was characterized by an extended definition of East, extending from Australia to East Asia with ASEAN at its core. And that phase also marked a shift from trade to wider economic and security issues, including efforts to protect sea lanes and coordinate counterterrorism activities. So there was a phase during that time when India-ASEAN relationship and also the Southeast Asia that it really grew and there was a lot that was being done. And then it plateaued. The relationship with ASEAN, India's engagement with Southeast Asia stagnated, barring a few bilateral relationships like that with Singapore. Rising tension with South China Sea and the East China Sea also increased the need to assure freedom of navigation through the waters, given India's own engagement with ASEAN countries coupled with its naval diplomacy to the region, there was an expectation from Delhi to play a role in maintaining peace and stability in Asia Pacific. However, India disappointed. At a time when our Southeast Asian friends were faced with a new security environment, an aggressive neighbor, there were expectations from India to play its role, that of a security actor in the region. India hesitated. And it did cost us. It cost us our credibility and created doubts among our friends, among its friends in New Delhi's on New Delhi's political appetite. So when India in 2014 stood up again and began showing interest in being a regional actor, there were few takers. As India moved from looking east to acting east, in 2014, Asia and the larger region welcomed it, but there were plenty of doubts. The region wanted India to be more present, for India to play a role. India's intentions were very much welcome, and countries were eager to engage, but everyone was asking the same question, can India deliver? Will India be able to stand on its own own vision as it has carved out for its engagements in the region? To a great extent, India did. India stepped up its cooperation and engagements, deepening its existing partnerships and built new ones. There is more engagement beyond its traditional friendship with Vietnam and Singapore, from lines of credit to patrol vessels and satellite tracking stations to high-level visits. There has been an effort to really start acting east and engaging with the East. But I think a difference between looking east and acting east is that while ASEAN was at the core of the locus policy, bilateral relationships and maybe trilateral or even new forms of multilateral is cooperation is likely to be at the center of this new act east policy. There is much more happening at the bilateral level than per se with just ASEAN. India-ASEAN relationship has been built up well. India has been a part of almost all platforms of that ASEAN has to offer. Apart from its own India-ASEAN summit, it has been an important partner and it will continue to be an important partner. But it will always be important to India's engagements in Southeast Asia. But there are limitations in taking the relationship forward, especially in the security security partnerships. I mean, 10 nations, 10 different political views, so there are constraints and challenges. India and ASEAN are already working on areas of converging interests, and there is much more to do, but perhaps the kind of engagement that New Delhi is seeking now, we will have to go beyond and explore new security configurations, both bilaterally and multilaterally. For example, white-shipping agreements, we have one with Singapore. We are exploring with other countries. If we can have an India-ASEAN white-shipping agreement, it would be brilliant. But but it could be a challenge, so why not explore it at a bilateral level with countries that are keen, and at some point try to bring that together under the existing mechanism. So maybe create one that is required and fuse all of the resources and shared tools that we have. The point is that there is momentum now, and it is important to not lose this momentum and keep pushing forward. Explore new ideas, rearrange configurations, build new one, do whatever it takes, basically, to keep pushing through with the ACTIST policy. And in fact, go beyond Southeast Asia. ACTIST is beyond ASEAN, right? Like, there's Japan. We have Japan, India-Japan relationship is going forward. We can explore partnerships with Japan, India, and Southeast Asian countries. I know Collin has written something about Japan, India, and Singapore, and there are discussions about creating more multilateral and bilateral relationships outside in it that fits very well in India's own ACTIST policy. Maritime cooperation is a focus point, and naval diplomacy can actually play a constructive role in India's ACTIST policy. Naval diplomacy has played a leading role in India's engagement with Southeast Asia anyway. There is a new security architecture in the horizon, and it is bound to happen. We have new rising powers in the region. India will have to decide for itself the role it wants to play, and more specifically, find a way to play that role it wants to play. The good news is the region is ready for a great engagement in India. It always has been. There is a demand. India has this massive opportunity to realize its own goals that it has set for itself in its engagement with Southeast Asia and East Asia. There might be a need for a fresh look at it, and its government. And this government has the political will to take in new ideas and take a fresh look and see what needs to be rearranged, what needs to be reconfigured, and perhaps come up with a new set of ideas and configurations that could suit well what our ASEAN friends needs, what Southeast Asian countries needs, and India needs. Before I end, I quickly wanted to also take a few minutes to specifically address India and South China Sea. I know we have experts on the panel, but it's something that's going to come up, and you can't really avoid it. Briefly, just to say what India thinks of the South China Sea or how it's going to engage in the South China Sea. India is not going to be a country challenging China's actions in the South China Sea. It won't respond to calls for freedom of navigation of operations by extra-regional powers, and it will maintain its distance from any engagements it views as a containment policy. If that is the expectation from the region, I don't think so there is any more. The region will definitely be disappointed. But India has made some great contributions lent its support to its friends. It continues its oil exploration with Vietnam, even in a block which has not been commercially viable. on Vietnam's request, that decision has a political tinge to it. It was in support of Vietnam's right to conduct commercial activities in its exclusive economic zone, even if unilaterally disputed. It continues to sail and fly and visit ports around the region. There has been a change in the tone of statements that India has put forward on the South China Sea. Prime Minister Modi brought up the issue with ASEAN, bilaterally with Vietnam, with Philippines. We chose to address the region as West Philippine Sea instead of the South China Sea in a bilateral document with Manila. We were one of the first countries to issue a statement in favor of establishing norms and rules and the UNCLOS during the Philippines versus China Permanent Court of Arbitration verdict in July last year. Even at that time, when ASEAN failed to reunite as one voice, India had lent its support voicing support of an international order that is in its favor. More importantly, I think India set a precedence in dispute resolution in maritime domain by accepting the verdict against itself in favor of Bangladesh by the same Permanent Court of Arbitration. India's approach was taken up as an example by the Philippines as it made its case in the arbitration court. It has sent as far as military exercises to challenge unilateral actions in the South China Sea is concerned. If ASEAN can come together and perhaps request India for joint patrols, India is likely to consider it, but on its own or at the request of an extra-regional power like the United States or even Japan or Australia, I don't think so. India is going to engage in something like that. And it's not in India's interest, but the question is, does it really have to be through military challenges? There are plenty of other ways to support and increase its presence by engaging more and more with bilateral countries, which India seems to be doing, through its statements, by coming forward at a time when its friends ask India for help specifically. As a concluding note, India should engage more bilaterally and explore new partnerships as it goes forward with its active policy. India-Southeast Asian relationship has not matched its potential, so it definitely has a lot more. It's only beginning to scratch the surface of what can actually be, so there's a lot more that can be done. And there is a demand. India hasn't been able to deliver as much. We have taken a new initiative, we have taken a step, but there's much more that can be done. But there is a new political will, new outlook, and a new environment. And more importantly, there is an intent. The challenge will be in implementing this intent, but if India can overcome its own hesitations, its own restrictions that it's imposed on itself, and the bureaucratic hurdles, which is, I guess, quite tough, but its active policy can be as successful as its locus policy, which established and deepened the India-ASEAN relationship. I'll stop here, and I'm happy to engage during Q&A, and I'm sure other panelists will have a lot of it. Thank you.
Good afternoon to everyone. I'm very delighted to be back here in New Delhi upon the invitation of Brookings India, particularly with Dhruva, who is a very good friend of mine, and maybe the prime reason why I'm here. What I'm talking to discuss here is to describe the changing security environment in Southeast Asia, and I will focus on the South China Sea because that is the crux of regional security situation. And I will discuss this in the context of our attempt to define India's evolving role in the region. So what's the current security situation now? I will focus on the South China Sea, but if you have some questions about international terrorism, I will also be glad to answer them during the open forum. But I will concentrate now on South China Sea dispute. If you look at the present security situation, there is what we call the calm moment. And if you know the reduction of security tension in Southeast Asia because of recent positive developments happening in the South China Sea. First is our own president's pragmatic paradigm shift to China, which currently resuscitates Philippines-China relations. We now have the persistent Thai diplomacy of Malaysia and Brunei, which sustains robust economic ties with China. We also have ongoing practical talks between Vietnam and China, which aim to pursue maritime cooperation. And things are going very well now. And China's very active promotion of development diplomacy, which is considered to be an innovative tool to promote preventive diplomacy in the South China Sea. And this development diplomacy is indicated through its two major projects, the One Belt, One Road project and the Maritime Silk Road project, and very recently the launching of the ASEAN Infrastructure Investment Bank, all initiated by China. There's also a cautious but cooperative attitude of Indonesia, Thailand, and Singapore, distant but still compliant behavior of Cambodia, Laos, and Myanmar, and more importantly, the conflict avoidance position of ASEAN. Right now, ASEAN is trying to avoid any conflict that will trigger any irritants in the area because of the existing China-ASEAN strategic partnership. Because this strategic partnership, which I consider to be more active than China-India strategic partnership, this solidifies friendship of cooperation between China and Southeast Asia. And I consider this type of friendship and cooperation as very essential in the prevention of any armed conflicts in the South China Sea. And if you will look around the region right now with the 10 ASEAN countries, also with China, there are new pragmatic outlooks and innovative directions taken by claimants and some pertinent players. And this contributed immensely to the positive improvement of security situation in the South China Sea, which I think very, very needed for the long-term stability of the region. Major players right now, including the Philippines, has appreciated the value of strategic restraints and to be more circumspect in their attitude by not overreacting when security irritants occasionally occur in South China Sea, like, for example, when the fake news occurred about China's intention to build a structure in the Scarborough Shoal. President Duterte did not react, did not overreact, unlike during the past where players overreact and it overblown the issue. But right now, players are now more circumspect in reacting on the issue. And I would like to focus more on Duterte's paradigm shift to China, because when he visited China in October 2016, something happened. You know, his visit to China created a conducive environment in Southeast Asia for everyone to cooperate. The Philippines signed 13 agreements, including defense-to-defense cooperation, and yielded a lot of economic assistance from China, amounting to $24 billion and more. That's why we have this kind of advertisement. But wait, there's more, a lot of economic assistance, and I will not mention that. But this is the very interesting project that our government wants to implement with China, the construction of port project in Davao City, and also the construction of the Davao Express Expressway to be funded by China. And China has also offered a credit worth $500 million to procure China-made military equipment to be used for counterinsurgency, counterterrorism, and most importantly, the favorite of our president, counter illegal drugs. Unfortunately, we don't know what to do with this money because we are not used to work with China on this matter. The Philippines also offered 40 projects to China for financing and 25 others for assistance with feasibility studies. And the Philippines accepted China's financial support and technical assistance to Duterte's war on drugs, and that's very, very, compared to the previous government, now the situation is very good. There is now the resumption of high-level interactions among officials between China and the Philippines, like, for example, the visit of China's foreign vice minister, Liu Xianmen, and the visit of Chinese minister of commerce, Zhong Chan, and very recently, the visit of Vice Premier Wang Yang, not to mention the forthcoming visit of our president to China in May at the occasion of the Over Summit. So a lot of things happen, and those things. And this is a good thing. China is also funding the rehabilitation of the oldest Chinatown in the world, which is the Binondo, the Chinatown in Manila, and China is funding that. Okay. So from the lowest moment of Philippines-China relations under President Aquino III, the two countries' bilateral ties have recently been remarkably brought to greater heights under the leadership of President Duterte. And President Duterte and President Xi Jinping, in fact, made a gentleman's agreement to promote stability in the South China Sea. And we're now benefited from that because of the positive development happening right now in the Scarborough Shoal, where Filipino fishermen are free to fish again. And they're not afraid of China Coast Guards anymore. In fact, they want the China Coast Guards to be around because of the previous experience last year where China Coast Guard vessels rescued our fishermen during the height of the typhoon. So leadership matters. And if you will look at the public opinion survey conducted by a Pew Research Center before the visit of President Duterte to China, the public opinion of the Philippines towards China was 54% only. But this is not bad, because that represents the global attitude of 55%, because every nation in the world that have that kind of positive attitude. But 91% of Filipinos expressed worries that territorial dispute with China in the South China Sea could lead to a military conflict. And China and the Philippines pay serious attention to that survey. So they want to avoid that issue just to sustain their momentum in promoting friendship and cooperation between the Philippines and China. And if you will look at the survey after the visit of President Duterte to China, China now has received positive 9 trust rating from Filipinos, compared before the visit, it's negative 33. So that's remarkable. Okay? So that's a remarkable change. And I think if there will be a survey to be conducted during this period, I think China will get more and more positive rating because of more and more positive developments happening between the Philippines and China. But wait, despite this what I call moment of calm, this calm moment may be a calm before the storm. Why? Because there are still security uncertainties that can stir up unnecessary trouble in the South China Sea, mainly due to the following unilateral actions of claimants. First, increased maritime patrols of all players, incessant infrastructure development and facilities improvements, especially the planned and actual setting up of maritime surveillance and monitoring posts or coastwatch stations in occupied features, not to mention island building activities, artificial island activities in the South China Sea. And there is also now a persistent acquisition of maritime assets for territorial protection and defense, and growing conduct of military exercise near or near the disputed waters. The Philippines is having another big exercise with the United States in a couple of weeks. And the intensified holding of other activities like island tourism, marine surveys, scientific researches, oil and natural gas explorations, and patriotic visits. All these unilateral actions are in fact indicative of fragility of the security situation in the area. And involvement of extra-regional powers in the South China Sea creates tremendous security uncertainties from China, and that can trigger potential conflict in the area. Particularly actions coming from the United States, Japan, India, Russia, Australia, and others. But China is more reacting to the actions of India and the United States and Japan. And we also have to bear in mind that there are also security implications of the arbitral ruling. Although our president right now is not raising the issue of arbitral ruling when talking to China, there are associated security implications that the Philippine government needs to address and deal and face squarely. Like, for example, the status of Filipino fishermen in Scarborough Shoal. They are enjoying fishing in the area not because of the arbitral ruling, because of the understanding between the Philippines and China. And not because of the arbitral ruling, and not because China recognizes our traditional fishing right in the area and recognizing our rights to exclusive economic zone in the area. It's just because China allowed it to happen. So it's very, very dangerous. And at the same time, this is a very high issue between the Philippines and China, the reed bank issue. Because right now, the contractor of the reed bank natural gas and oil project is now asking from the Philippine government on whether or not to resume the activities. But the President Duterte said, we cannot resume yet because China does not like it. You see. Okay, so, but the reed bank is very, very important for us because we need to develop that resources, particularly in the context of the situation in Malampaya oil field. Okay, it will last not more than 10 years, so we need an alternative source of natural gas to propel our own economic activities. And more importantly, security of Philippine troops pursuing resupply and rotation missions, not to mention maintenance and reconstruction missions in our occupied features in the Kalayaan Island Group. And if you will look at this area, this is our exclusive economic zone, but these are all the part of the Kalayaan Island Group. Okay, and we have some issues about that because in that area, okay, you mentioned about the South China Sea replacing it with the West Philippine Sea. I need to express this again. The concept of West Philippine Sea is not a substitute to the concept of the South China Sea. When we talk about West Philippine Sea, we're not talking about the whole South China Sea. We are just talking about the 30% of the waters that we think belong to our waters as mandated by the United Nations Conference of Beyond the Sea. So when we talk about the West Philippine Sea, this is the only West Philippine Sea and not a substitute to the South China Sea. Okay? And China is claiming around 95% of all the waters in the South China Sea. The Philippines only claiming the West Philippine Sea, which is only 25% of the total waters in the South China Sea. And that 25% is mandated by our sovereign rights, okay, as enshrined in the United Nations Convention of the Law of the Sea. So we talk about West Philippine Sea, it's the only area of the maritime domain that we are describing. Okay. And in this area, in the West Philippine Sea, China has already established 7 artificial islands. So, and it's creating a lot of problems with us because that can also limit our activities in the area, not only economic activities, but our own sovereign rights activities and sovereign power activities. I cannot move it. Can you slide, please? Okay. Go ahead. Because my time is running out. Because I have three very important slides that will talk about China's India's role in the area, and we spent two days of brainstorming in our office just to talk about this issue. Just imagine I spent 12 hours in the airplane to talk about 10 minutes here. But it's okay, it's worth it.
It's worth it.
Okay. Good. Okay, now that area, can I click this now? Okay, good.
Oh, yeah.
So if you look at this artificial island, that was the original structure. I got this from a source in the Philippine Navy, but this is my favorite slide. Better than the slide being propagated by the CSIS, ASEAN Maritime Transparency Initiative. This is better, but because if you look at this, I love the way, you know, Filipinos, they are so innovative. They know how to present it beautifully. Look at this. In 2013, now look at now the situation. Terrible transformation. Okay, so I'll rush. So the Calderon Reef, from the original, is now the, because you see the transformation is so big. It's quantum leap forward. You know, it's tremendous. It's an enormous makeover. If you will look at from the original structure. And I will not be surprised if China can do that. Because if China can build the Great Wall, they can also build just imagine, they can build the Great Wall in the mountains, so they can build the sea wall in the South China Sea. And this is the sea wall in the South China Sea. I got this from CSIS because this is the most current figure, yeah, because March 9, 2017. Yeah. And Kinan Reef. I'm not part of CSIS, ASEAN Maritime Transparency Initiative. I'm part of the other effort, the Maritime Awareness Project of the Sasakawa Peace Foundation and the National Bureau of Asian Research. But look at this. Just imagine the transformation. Okay? And China did that in the span of 2 years. Okay? And while the arbitration process was going on. And now how can we talk about arbitration process, the result of arbitration process, where China has already transformed the realities on the ground. There is now a new normal situation which undermines all the decisions of the arbitral ruling. So for me, that is very, very problematic on the part of the Philippines, and also making the security situation in the South China Sea very, very fragile and unsustainable. It's all about China's control. So just look at all this figure. Now, what's the future directions now? Well, the future directions, that despite the meeting in Cambodia, because there was a recent meeting of China and ASEAN in Cambodia, there's a need to expeditionally finalize and seriously adopt the framework for the ASEAN-China Code of Conduct in the South China Sea. It's very important to have that as a confidence-building measure. Although we're talking about the framework, it's very good that we decide on the framework because we can get China into the process. What's important is we have to sustain this engagement with China. Second, promote and sustain high-level exchanges of officials in charge of the South China Sea dispute. This is my observation of the previous years. When there is a collapse of high-level exchanges, there was also the deterioration of the security environment. But if there is a exchange of high-level officials, okay, the security situation in the area is being managed. Then widen the scope of bilateral and multilateral South China Sea relations through practical functional cooperation in order to seriously pursue the original objectives of the declaration of the conduct of parties in the South China Sea. And what are these objectives? Here, marine environmental protection, marine scientific research, safety of navigation and communication at sea, search and rescue operation, and combating transnational crimes, etc., including terrorism. And I think that will be the crux of the forthcoming China-Philippines maritime security dialogue. To talk about possible area of cooperation. And aside from those things identified by the declaration of the conduct of parties in the South China Sea, Philippines and ASEAN can also explore other ways of cooperation in the area of coordinated patrols, coast guard cooperation, or common fishery zone arrangements, like in the case of China and Vietnam, or joint field service of natural resources, joint military exercises for humanitarian assistance and disaster response, or also to promote non-traditional security. And there's also a need to have some sort of annual maritime security dialogue or forum between China and ASEAN countries to build further confidence and generate mutual trust and understanding, and development of China-ASEAN mechanism for conflict avoidance, early warnings, and crisis management, like, for example, the adoption of the QS in Southeast Asia and creation of hotlines between China and ASEAN countries. We also need to intensify the process of China-ASEAN dialogue in the South China Sea to implement the DOC and to conclude the COC, like, for example, the work of the Joint Working Group, the senior officials meeting, and we are now proposing the creation of eminent person and experts group, okay, in the South China Sea, because their ideas, their wisdom is really very, very essential to promote friendship and cooperation. And finally, to support the operation of China-Southeast Asia Regional Center on the South China Sea. It's composed of China and Southeast Asian experts, and I'm very honored to be part of the board of this China-Southeast Asia Research Center on the South China Sea. Okay. Now, this is now the battle cry of China right now if you want to maintain peace and security in the South China Sea. Set aside dispute and pursue joint development. We have disagreements, but now we agree to disagree. And now China now accepts the ASEAN principle of agreeing to disagree. But China's Maritime Silk Road project provides bridges of cooperation. Now China is talking about building roads, building ports, building bridges in Southeast Asian countries. And do you know what? Even China has promised to finance the construction of bridge in Visayan Island of the Philippines connecting Negros and Panay Island. Okay? And that is through China's initiative. Okay? And what's now India's role considering those discussions? Well, this is my observation. India's cultural and historical influence in Southeast Asia have been historically disproven. We cannot deny that fact. But this influence has not been fully harnessed by both parties. Okay. Second, India's relations with ASEAN and individual Southeast Asian countries are multifaceted, but they have not been fully harmonized and are concentrated on trade and investment. Okay. Third, through the years, India's strategic and defense ties with Southeast Asia countries have improved, but these have not been fully utilized. Okay, a lot of diplomatic niceties, but it's not been fully utilized for actual work. And India has strengthened ties with mainland Southeast Asia, as stated earlier this morning in the discussion, but more efforts are needed to strengthen ties with maritime Southeast Asia, particularly with Indonesia, Singapore, Malaysia, Brunei, and the Philippines. ASEAN is at the core of India's Arctic policy, but if you will look at the facts, India's trade connectivity with ASEAN is the weakest compared to ASEAN's major trading partners. India is at the bottom of the heap. So talk about acting East policy, look at the figure. This is evidence. So you have to do more. You have to act more. You know, you have to act more because you are at the bottom of the heap compared to ASEAN's major trading partners. In terms of strategic competition with China in Southeast Asia, India needs to act faster as China is acting quantum leap forward to promote its maritime Silk Road project in the region. To be blunt, China is bankrolling the economic growth of Southeast Asia. Can India match that effort? In the Philippines alone, the Philippines says, what do you want to buy to China? We will buy it. What do you want from us? Why are you asking Japan for assistance? We will provide it. What do you need from the United States? We will give it to you. Just imagine that strong words of China to the Philippines. Okay. And China has a bigger strategic intention in doing so. India should demonstrate to Southeast Asia that New Delhi is not only a reliable economic partner, but also a credible security provider, okay, and an effective power balancer. Are you an effective balancer or just an effective posturer? Are you just posturing or you're just really balancing? Southeast Asia has high expectations of India's positive role in the maintenance of peace and stability in the South China Sea. And I can speak on that because I've been talking to a lot of Southeast Asian experts viewing India, and there are a lot of expectations about India, expectations that India itself has created. Okay. You created these expectations. So we are expecting you to deliver. Okay. So where's the delivery of the goods? Southeast Asia needs further clarity from India on how its active policy can contribute to peace and stability in Southeast Asia, particularly in the South China Sea. And I would like to end my presentation by quoting this favorite statement from Moody. In foreign policy, it's not necessary to have similar views. Yeah, we accept that. Even when the views are contradictory, talks are the only way forward and problems should be resolved through dialogue. I thought you're acting, or you're still emphasizing dialogue. China is acting very fast. India needs to act faster. Thank you very much.
Okay, when the slides are being set up, I'd like to first thank Brookings India, especially Dhruva, for your kind invitation. My fourth time here to New Delhi, and every of my experience here has been very fruitful. And I think this one is certainly not an exception. So I'm here to also learn from everybody. This is a very interesting gathering of not just the academia like myself, but also from the policy practitioner side. It's very interesting. And I think my presentation is on Southeast Asia, and I'm afraid to say that I might potentially duplicate some of what my friend Rommel here is talking about. I'll be a bit more focused here, and of course, my field is in the maritime security, so my presentation is going to be largely geared towards this direction. And I must say, I mean, the sort of disclaimer also is that I don't claim to be speaking for all 10 Southeast Asian countries. I don't think you're also speaking for all 10. So we are here to just put forward sort of a think tank perspective to how we look at this region. It's a very interesting, diverse region of 10 countries, and it also speaks of a very complex and diverse geostrategic context we are speaking here. So I will begin my presentation to highlight that, you know, we have 10 countries, varying circumstances, priorities that set forth varying perspectives on the evolving what we will use as the Indo-Pacific maritime environment. So now, I think we just put diverse threat perceptions aside. I think there are some very common characteristics that I think we can observe in Southeast Asia. I think every country will not hesitate to agree that it is necessary to create an environment that is stable, is peaceful, is rules-based, and it will be conducive for socio-economic development. And by extension, this includes safe and secure access to the seas. And we're referring to the Indo-Pacific littoral region. So this is basically what we're talking about. And before we talk about changes in the security environment, we talk about some of the immutable constants here, especially geography. I don't think you can choose neighbors. We are all fixed here. And I think something that will never change for Southeast Asian countries, now of whom we could label itself as a major power, is that we're essentially sandwiched between the various powers. We just draw a line, we are all boxed up. And oh yeah, I forgot, we have a good friend here, the US. So, and practically, I mean, if I could use a sort of analogy, is that we are practically a school of herrings swimming in the midst of whales and sharks. So this is going to be a constant limiting factor as to how Southeast Asian countries think of geopolitics in the region, and what we will call a geostrategic reality that gives rise to the constraints in the way we perceive the security environment, as well as giving rise to limited strategic options to cope with the external pressure and from within. So now we go on to changes, and we'll take stock of what happened in the more recent years in the predominantly maritime Southeast Asian environment over the past 1 year. And I think I will use South China Sea as a focal point. Just now, Rommel has given a very comprehensive update, so I will not aim to replicate the very comprehensive outline that he has given, this semi-enclosed body of waters is directly, indirectly, will affect all Southeast Asian countries, no matter what, in terms of geographical proximity, as well as the fact that every now and then the South China Sea problem will loom in the shadow of our ASEAN processes anyway. And surprisingly, I think it's something that has been much anticipated prior to the run-up to July 12th last year, when the ruling came about, was that people were really concerned that, you know, after the ruling comes out, there will be some instability. For example, armed hostilities in the South China Sea, but this didn't come about. As Roman has mentioned, the situation has remained rather tenuous, but still stable. But again, I will echo what Roman has said, emphasize that the situation is far from assuring. I think what the arbitral ruling has failed to resolve or properly address are flowing. The first is the continued military Coast Guard activities by the various claimants and non-claimants alike. And I think the second thing that is going to stick with us is that great power rivalries. Such dynamics have clearly gone beyond the disputes per se. And these are the realities of the South China Sea. And at the risk of provoking some controversy here, because I think there's more than one occasion that I spoke last year and this year, and after speaking about these issues, I've been put aside by some policymakers questioning why am I questioning some of their proposals. And again, I mean, I have to put forward some pessimistic scenario. I think just now, Roman has mentioned about the framework for the court conduct. I think I agree, we need to sign that framework. But the framework is a framework. What I understand is that it's a framework, it's just a piece of paper. It's a one-page piece of paper that these 10 ASEAN countries and China are grappling with for many years, and we are going to sign it in the middle of this year. And of course, from the positive angle, it's good because this move will demonstrate the political will to resolve the problems in South China Sea. But I must also say that, you know, if you look at it more realistically, some of the political leadership in Southeast Asia, they don't push for it for altruistic reasons. I think in a way, it's a manner to showcase some foreign policy achievement, is for the preservation of political legitimacy back home. And that's why it is a problem. I will approach this call of conduct more from the arms control angle. And we often forget that, you know, we call that confidence building measure. But the call of conduct is designed to arrest militarization. By extension, this is a concept of naval arms control. And by naval arms control, we talk about two types. The first type is structural naval arms control, where we talk about limiting the types, the quantity of weapon systems. If you go by history, this type of arms control can never go anywhere far. There's no way you can tell people that you cannot buy this or that in certain quantities. What we are betting on is our operational naval arms control, which we are referring to as how you limit the way you deploy your weapon system. And this is your mode of deployment that matters. It's not. It doesn't prejudice the type and as well as the quantity of weapon systems you acquire. This is an issue here because, you know, even if we talk about operational naval arms control, I think in my view, I think we are faced with a long-term problem here. We can push for this to come, but it will essentially face the same issues as those old arms control negotiations that talk about weapon systems. Mainly, therefore, we are talking about the case of compliance. We're talking about the case of verification. We're talking about the case of enforcement. These three elements, what we call the CVE factors, are also prevalent in an operational naval arms control mechanism, such as the COC. You can agree about something now, you sign the dotted line. The next question is, so what? How far can you implement the agreement? If you just take only one party out of the 11, just go against agreement and do something against it, effectively the core conduct is a failure. And the question here is it going to haunt us in the future? If not for the present generation of ASEAN leaders, is it going to haunt the future generation of ASEAN leadership? Are we able to grapple with the potential risks that come about when people start to question whether ASEAN is able to contribute constructively to regional stability, or are we just undermining the process? So this is the uncertainty factor that we are going to grapple with. But overall, I think enough the South China Sea problem, only to say that there is a lot of uncertainties in store. What's going to happen next after middle this year when we sign the framework, we go on to the actual negotiation about the details about the, whether it's legally binding, how enforceable it is, we have to take a bit of time. But now I have to put forth to you the not so bad news. Not so bad news is that the disputes don't constitute the key problem for all ASEAN countries. Disputes, great power rivalries, are part and parcel of geopolitical life in the region, and they will require long-term proper management to come to resolve quickly. But it will bring attention to you here is that even for Vietnam, a country that has largely focused on the South China Sea as the main maritime security problem for decades, recently there are new problems coming up. The issue of marine pollution along the coastline. And one recall this high-profile case involving Formosa Plastics, which is this Taiwanese company that discharged toxic waste from its steel plant. And it causes what we will deem as a marine ecosystem catastrophe along the coast of four provinces. And just recently, the Vietnam government has said that a US $500 million compensation for the Taiwanese company wouldn't be sufficient to mitigate the disaster in the long term. So I'll venture to say that using this example, that the South China Sea problem, it is one problem. But many Southeast Asian countries find themselves tackling a whole range of what we will deem as non-traditional security problems. Now the thing is, you know, this idea of how non-traditional these problems are can amount to one separate workshop of its own, can debate how non-traditional it is, because many of these problems are faced by these countries for decades. So they are not exactly very non-traditional in a way. But I would like to posit here the varying maritime security threat perceptions. Based on my years of research inquiry, I test my initial assumptions, and then I collaborated with open source policy materials as well as my personal interactions with regional governments. You'll find that in this whole laundry list of maritime security issues, the main problems here that people face are non-traditional in nature. Things that don't really require militarized solutions. And there are softer challenges, IUU phishing, for example, seaborne human trafficking, navigational safety issues. They don't require militarized approaches. And of course, the maritime security capacity requirements are very much different. And this is also one of the reasons why in the more recent years, we have seen the emergence of civilian maritime law enforcement agencies, coast guards, and marine police, for example. And over the many decades, however, since 1945, nothing much has changed when it comes to capacity. Here's the thing. If you go by the proportion, the land-water proportion, and look at the assets that are being mastered, it's an issue. I'm sure that Rommel will agree with me. If you look at Singapore and the Philippines, number of ships, the Philippines is, on paper, one ship more than ours. But, you know, the maritime expense that the Philippines have to police is way larger than Singapore's. What we are facing here is, to cut the story short, is we are seeing here an uneven capacity among Southeast Asian countries, which are not proportionate to the entire maritime zones that each of these countries are supposed to police. So this is a persistent capacity issue, and therefore, I think to deal with this issue, there are a few ways to do it. One is that, of course, there's no lack of cooperating mechanism at the ASEAN level, mainly in the bilateral level, but more recently, multilateral, and more commonly, these days, and getting more fashionable, is what we call mini-lateral format. A good example here is that this coming 11th of this month, Indonesia, Malaysia, and the Philippines are going to start off with the patrols in the Sulu Sea. This is one example of what we call mini-lateral. You have countries sharing a small sub-regional local context with the same problems, and you form a coalition of the willing to come together to deal with the problem. So this is more manageable, they're smaller, and they're more practical compared to the larger ASEAN one sort of agreement. We're going to see more of this coming. But the other reason that, you know, cooperation can be a problem is, again, contradicts the reason why countries need to cooperate in the first place that I talked about, is the lack of capacity. Without the lack of capacity, some countries hesitate to cooperate because they will feel that you're coming in as a lesser player, a lesser partner, and there's issue of face as well. So this is another point that will hinder them. So for the foreseeable future, my assessment is that Southeast Asian governments will put more focus on building national capacity, largely as a way to build their own resilience. But what I see here is that extra-regional powers such as India, can actually tap on the niche capabilities to provide those assistance to ASEAN governments' maritime security capacity. But I think I have to stress that one of the reality that come along with it is that many of these assistances could be easily politicized. For example, Japan's outreach to Southeast Asian countries has been painted as counterbalancing against China. But we often neglect that, you know, there are some real practical benefits that such assistance will provide. A good example here is that Japan recently delivered the first pair of what we call multi-role rescue vessels to the Philippine Coast Guard. And not too long after, these two vessels are put into service in the Sulu Sea to contribute to security. This is a tangible contribution, a tangible result of this capacity building. It goes beyond the media headlines of Japan trying to counterbalance China. This is something that we look upon as a more pragmatic perspective. So not just Japan, but going by the foreseeable adherence to an inclusive approach to regional architecture building, I think ASEAN countries will continue to accept help from various countries around us, including India. And of course, we have to bear in mind that it's not just China. When these countries get help in some ways, financial or some form of donations from China, these countries like Malaysia and Philippines, they also get some assistance from the other powers, like Japan, as well as from India. So the question here is, what about India? What are the ways that India could assist Southeast Asia in coping with the maritime challenges? I will couch this as the key platform of how I will approach India's at-ease policy. And I use the time framework. The time framework is a very typical framework that strategies will use. How you bridge resources with your policy outcomes. So essentially, you talk about grand strategy. And grand strategy is something that is bigger, is grander, because it talks more about more than just military. Because we talk about strategy, we're talking about the military forces. When we talk about grand strategy, we're talking about all tools at the disposal of government, in this case, India. And I refer to D as the diplomatic perspectives. I is information, M military, E as the economic. So first, I will say that, you know, all these four pillars, they don't exist in silos. They cross-cut each other. So the first component, which is going to be diplomacy, first call upon India to remain as a strong beacon for rules-based Indo-Pacific order. In fact, I see strong convergences between India and ASEAN for this. Both institutions are strong advocates of the rule of law in addressing dispute. And I think New Delhi's peaceful settlement of the maritime boundary dispute with Bangladesh that Darshana mentioned about. And of course, the adherence to the PCA ruling that grants Bangladesh a bigger portion of the contested area is a model for emulation. And I think that it would be ideal for India to keep demonstrating that despite the relative size of the countries in this dispute, might isn't right. This is very important. This at ease carries a very strong moral aspect, a very strong moral dimension that I thought India could fill the role appropriately. In this connection, I believe that India can continue to be a strong advocate for ASEAN centrality and to help build the desired architecture that's inclusive and not prone to domination by any one great power. And notwithstanding its mixed record, I believe ASEAN countries or ASEAN will continue to serve as a platform to bring all parties together, including China, India, Japan, and the US. In connection to the maritime realm, I would propose that India will take a leading role to push for a greater profile of the expanded ASEAN Maritime Forum. The EMMF has been raised earlier, which I thought we don't see much of traction over these years. And we are talking about 10 ASEAN countries and 8 dialogue partners. So instead of creating radically new structures to cope with maritime challenges, the EMMF could provide the potential to serve such a role. We can build on it. So here's my proposal. It is to build what we call sectoral working groups at the maritime practitioner level. When we talk about maritime practitioner level, referring to the various maritime agencies, like the Navy, Coast Guard, and the Maritime Administration, to come together to deal with the more pertinent, more common issues on hand, like maritime terrorism, cooperation between navies and coast guards, navigational safety, and more importantly, sustainable fishery management, just to name a few. And I thought, for information aspect, I think this is an area that is relevant for India's involvement. I think maritime domain awareness naturally comes to mind. India can leverage on two major strengths. One is the major IT strength, as well as the space satellite launch technology. And I think the IT industry will be helpful to facilitate the creation of an integrated network of maritime information sharing nodes across the Indo-Pacific. You don't have to just do it alone. And I think India could work together with countries like Japan, and you can find that complementary. Japan is now offering transfers of their older maritime patrol aircraft and other assets for maritime domain awareness. I think what we need here is to bring all these pictures together to form a more coherent info sharing mode across the region. The Indian Space Research Organization could also assist ASEAN governments with the development of microsatellites for maritime domain awareness and of course real-time data link information fusion and sort of dissemination. And MDA information sharing is not just what shipping that Darshana mentioned about, but it could expand to other areas like underwater awareness to promote maritime safety. And by that, I'm not referring, don't get me wrong, I'm not referring to submarines operating countries sharing submarine movements. We're referring to the sharing of the underwater terrain and obstacles to promote submarine safety. That is something that Singapore is very, very keen to work on. And in fact, we are going to launch a new portal that talks about submarine safety, information sharing. So this is one area to also for India to explore working on. As far as the M aspect is concerned, and I think this is an area that holds immense potential. I think so far, there are very close naval relations between India and Singapore, between India and Vietnam. And there are those areas that already exist, such as the provision of technical and training assistance, can be further expanded to include the other ASEAN partners. I think perhaps India could actually, you know, look at an area where, you know, Australia is currently doing. I could put for example here, what they deem as the Pacific Patrol Boat Program. Is it possible for India to emulate this program, targeting largely Southeast Asian countries in need of simpler offshore patrol capabilities? Having some common platform and able to build interoperability as well as commonality in terms of certain basic spare parts that could be shared amongst the various Southeast Asian countries. If not the Navy, but maybe the Coast Guards. And I think in this area, India could leverage on its strong shipbuilding capacity, such as what Goa Shipbuilding Limited is also doing, for example. So this is just one model to look at the Australian Pacific Patrol Boat Program that could be expanded to include the bigger region. And I thought India perhaps could explore this together with Australia to look at the wider region, not just the Pacific Islands. And finally, the blue economy. This is will be one economic pillar, the last part of DIME, that I thought will be interesting. I think there are much interactions between India and Southeast Asia when it comes to trade and commerce. But currently, as part of the Act is, India is pushing for greater interconnectivity that was being mentioned in the earlier panel. But one area I think has direct relevance is the blue economy. So far in Southeast Asia, this concept has not gained much traction, except for only a handful of Southeast Asian countries. I thought, even though blue economy has become a key agenda within the Indian Ocean Rim Association, I thought this is appropriate for India to try to push it as an agenda to look at, to explore at a wider Indo-Pacific region with ASEAN as a key player. So I think all these can be linked and coordinated with regional mechanisms such as the Coral Triangle Initiative to promote sustainable fishery management. And I think the objective is to try to make it more widely accepted across the Indo-Pacific, not just the Indian Ocean. So with that, I end my rather brief presentation, and I welcome any further comments later.
So my bit for this presentation has been purely defense and security, and therefore, as you can see on the slide, the theme of the session has been projected. But to start with, I wish to remind everybody that geography is destiny. And this should never be forgotten by you. You can't choose your neighbors, nor can you keep lamenting on the terrain or climate or the configuration of your land is concerned, that it is not as good as A or B country. But many people, when it comes to India, think of the geography of India being a revenge, if not of history, but of geography. Taking a leaf, incorrectly interpreting a leaf out of Robert Kaplan's book. Is that true? Looking at that, people say, good Lord, look at the distance between ASEAN and India. And they think it's a handicap to be so far away, the burden of distance. Actually, there is no handicap in so far as the maritime domain or the environment of the seas is concerned. Because the constraint of distance is superseded by the ease with which you can traverse from point A to point B. We keep forgetting that 71% of Mother Earth is composed of water. And that's where the difference lies between land and the sea. Because the sea offers none handicaps of terrain, of topography, or of boundaries and borders, except the territorial waters where you can seek diplomatic clearances and even visit countries which have no objections to you visiting. Therefore, I wish to remind you, before I proceed further, that the sea unites while the land divides, for reasons that are universally known. Therefore, having said that, we also keep forgetting those countries which exist around India, that India does not exist on mainland or on the peninsula. India also exists 800 miles to the east, the Andaman Nicobar Islands, which are almost co-located with the most northerly and the most westerly ASEAN countries. In fact, the hub of ASEAN. 22 miles from the southernmost island of Myanmar, 200 miles from Thailand, almost the same distance from Malaysia, and 80 miles from Sabah in Indonesia. That's the distance. So if you were to shift the same compass with its fulcrum resting on this part of India, look at the advantage of geography as against the revenge of geography. That circle of 800 miles covers 70% of ASEAN. But why am I showing only 700 miles? When it comes to the maritime domain, even a small frigate or a corvette can have its sea legs going as far as 4,000 nautical miles without having to refuel or taking any other logistics. So you can cover right up to the northern part of Japan without having to refuel. That's the advantage of maritime forces in the maritime domain for maritime states. So where is there a restriction or limitation to defense and security cooperation between maritime neighbors? Because distance is not a limitation, not a criteria, not an overriding factor. But before we proceed towards cooperation, one more aspect needs to be remembered when it comes to the Indian Ocean part of the Indo-Pacific. This is the smallest of the three oceans that allow global economic engagement, transaction of business, and yet it is the most critical out of the three, despite being the smallest. Because anyone who has to go from the Atlantic to the Pacific or vice versa, particularly between India and ASEAN, and economies in the Atlantic or economies resident in the Pacific, have no choice but to transit through the Indian Ocean. But the Indian Ocean is the only ocean which has no large gateways and windows as access to the world. It has got 8 critical choke points. Starting with the Cape of Good Hope, which is a half choke point. It has land only on one side, yet it is a choke point. Mozambique Channel. The Gulf of Aden of Bab al-Mandab. And I'll stop here to remind you, why am I talking of choke points? Because choke points are havens, God sent havens for those who indulge in transnational crime like piracy. Remember the Gulf of Aden? Just 2 days ago, another Dhow of flag under Indian flag has been hijacked by Somali pirates after a gap of almost 5 years of peace in that area, with almost 9 navies still continuing to patrol the Gulf of Aden. The Suez Canal, the Strait of Hormuz, the only exit for the Persian Gulf, which hosts 40% of the world's oil and gas, and the Malacca, Sunda and Lombok Straits. 17.2 million barrels of oil passes through the Strait of Hormuz every day. 15.4 passes through the Malacca, Sunda or Lombok Straits. So we are talking of almost two-thirds of the global economy transiting by the mercantile fleet through this area. And 60% of that passes through the South China Sea. But what allows the South China Sea entry from the Indian Ocean? The Malacca, Sunda and the Lombok Straits. And that's where my friend from Indonesia will remember Pawasan Nusantara. It is thanks to the UNCLOS, the law of the sea, that the Indonesia, that the Indonesian archipelago, which is the largest archipelago in the world, handed on the platter to the world its own sea lanes, the archipelagic sea lanes of Malacca, Sunda, Lombok, and Ambaiweta to the world as international transit routes, as international straits, even though they are internal waters to Indonesia. But these choke points are extremely critical, and one has to guard against transnational crime through preventive measures, which can only happen through cooperation in defense and security, particularly through maritime forces, whether it is navies or coast guards. So having said all this, now you can look at the revenge of geography. It is actually an advantage of geography, insofar as India and ASEAN are concerned. Look at the two island chains belonging to India in the west and the east. They permit transit of the most important east-west routes, the 8-degree and the 10-degree channels, the 8-degree and the 6-degree channels. And how close is the Malacca Strait, the mouth of the Malacca Strait, to the Andaman Nicobar Islands? So what is it that India can provide? Just as in the Andaman Seas and at the mouth of the Malacca Straits, India does patrolling as a matter of routine through ships and aircraft. It also sends its submarines, not just for patrolling, not just for the sake of surveillance, in order to find out if somebody who has no business to be coming is coming in and what is it doing, but also for the sake of cooperation. It is in the early 90s that the Republic of Singapore Navy was assisted by the Indian Navy without having talked of this themed vein of multilateralism or bilateralism in defense and security cooperation to share the practice of submarining well before the Republic of Singapore Navy thought of buying submarines. We have done likewise for Vietnam, we have done likewise for Myanmar. What for? Not for the sake of preparing for war, not for the sake of building and sprucing an arms race, but for the sake of defense of each nation's maritime domain and integrity. And that is where bilateral cooperation, so far as ASEAN is concerned, actually somehow supersedes multilateralism. Because ASEAN was never built as a multilateral security pact. It was not meant to be that. And multilateralism, I don't think, can really work over here, except in one aspect, which I'm sure. That's Milam. 3 years after the Look East policy was initiated by India, in 1995, as a very small initiative, the Indian Navy's Eastern Naval Command, under which the Andaman Nicobar fortress used to exist those days, came up with the idea of calling Southeast Asian navies for a multilateral meeting of mines, naval contingents, and if possible ships at Port Blair. the capital port city of that Union Territory. And every 2 years since then, we've been doing that. It started off with just four representing nations, sending in either contingents or ships. The last one was held in 2014. We couldn't do one in 16 because the International Fleet Review was taking place in that. There would have been a conflict of events. And in 2014, we had 17 nations either sending in their ships or only delegations for 6 days at Port Blair for a conference which takes place each time Milan takes place with a theme of either maritime search and rescue or humanitarian assistance and disaster relief or fighting and preventing transnational crime or mitigating effects of natural disasters. Out of these 17 nations, now this is the only element of multilateralism which will work, and I suggest that this be encouraged to proliferate as far as possible by ASEAN countries. Out of the 17 nations which sent their delegations or delegations and ships, 7 ASEAN nations also came. Philippines and Cambodia came for the first time with their vessels, apart from delegations, apart from Myanmar, Thailand, Malaysia, Indonesia, Singapore. 5 of them sent their ships. That leaves 3. PDR now cannot be expected to have ships, but they are. We have always sent to landlocked countries, the more the merrier, because after all, economic engagement of landlocked countries like Liechtenstein, Switzerland, or Austria takes place only through by way of the sea. So is the case with Laos. So is the case with Nepal, Bhutan. So it is not just ceremonials like city parades in Milan or fun and games by sunset, but serious business of exercising the basics and the complex varieties of exercise. That is where sharing of wisdom with best practices comes in. And this is where multilateralism really pays off. We are seeing the dividends and through the results in every bilateral, consecutive, successive bilateral exercise that we do, that there are larger delegations and bigger ships coming in from various countries. So imagine, where we started with only a small grouping of very close neighbors like Indonesia, Malaysia, and Thailand, it's now spread from as far west as Kenya and Tanzania, and as far east and south as New Zealand in 2014. Apart from that, we have also for the past couple of years been doing what is called CORPACs, coordinated patrols. It started off as a very small initiative between India and Indonesia. Then it spread to India and Thailand, and now it's gone to India and Myanmar. With these 3 countries, around their respective international maritime boundary lines, twice in a year we do coordinated patrols with the acronym CORPAC. What does it do? It encourages confidence building. It creates avenues for interoperability. It brings home synergy of operation. It allows doctrines to be made common for any eventuality. And that's what cooperation really leads to. So this is the method of doing bilateral defense and security cooperation. Now this picture shows you an exercise which was bilateral as part of CORPAC twice a year between Indian and Thai navies. That's between Indian and Myanmar navies. Now the picture on top shows you on the left side the Indian naval patrol vessel which is based in Port Blair called Saryu, which went to Myanmar for the last exercise, the CORPAC. And the one on the right, with the red arrow, is the first frigate made indigenously by Myanmar. They took quite some time, like India took a hell of a lot of time while making its first frigate on its own. But this is where the second step of defense and security cooperation comes in. For that frigate, India provided the main surveillance radar. Not a navigation radar, but the main surveillance radar. And most of communication is electronic. That's beyond sharing best practices. That is true cooperation. To help those who are lesser haves or who do not have the benefit of technology. Like India missed the Industrial Revolution. It kept receiving technologies first from the West, particularly the UK after our independence, and then from the Soviet Union. And now we've become completely self-reliant, almost completely. That's the picture for bilaterals between Indonesia and India, the core pacts. And from last year onwards, apart from the coordinated patrols between India and Indonesia and the mouth or the funnel of the Malacca Straits within the IMBL, around the IMBL of the two countries, we've also started doing bilateral exercises. And hopefully by this year, we will start doing similar things with Malaysia. Overseas diplomats. The days of Indian Navy doing goodwill visits to nations to earn brownie diplomatic points are over. Now we do overseas diplomats for the sake of A, sharing our own doctrines, best practices, B, for building confidence, C, for flag showing in a very sweet manner, not what is pejoratively known as gunboat diplomacy. That is utilized only when there is a real need. So this picture shows you the four ships that went from the Eastern Fleet of India. Each year, a few ships are taken by the fleet commander from the Eastern Fleet, going up the Western Pacific, visiting various friendly countries. Last year, because RIMPAC, the Rim of Pacific exercise, was to be staged by the United States Navy, which does it every 2 years, at Hawaii, where almost 70 nations are represented. Apart from going and taking part in that exercise, on the way up, these ships visited Vietnam, exercised with their Navy, Republic of Korea, Philippines, and a few other countries. And same way on the way back. Where did these four ships have to go through? Which particular trade route or which water body did they have to go through for doing what they did? Not around Australia, but through the South China Sea. And what was the caption on this picture a few months after they had finished by some people on the internet from the West? Finally, India presents a deterrent posture by patrolling the South China Sea. That's a bit longer. We do not ever deter anyone except one who casts an evil eye at us. We are not a resident power in the Pacific. We haven't got claims to any territories, but we respect and make sure that everyone more powerful or less powerful, understands the basics of the law of the sea, particularly if they too have signed and ratified the UNCLOS in 1982 or thereafter. So we do patrols which are called joint patrols, as Darshana mentioned, or combined patrols, bilaterally, as part of overseas deployments. But we do not do patrols which are being called deterrent to prove a point in the South China Sea. Which means that when you exercise with friendly nations within the South China Sea, it does irritate somebody. But that's it. We are not claiming any territory. Nor are we trying to say that this is a joint patrol for the sake of passing a message on to a particular country. Because we have no dispute over that. So, going through the South China Sea, many a time we've been told this is not your waters, this is so-and-so country's territory, and I'm obviously talking of China. We've said, please identify yourselves, whoever is saying so, and please come up front. And thereafter the voice suddenly dies down. That is a point which is proved by India time and again. So what is the finally aim of bilateral defense and security cooperation? Combined exercises for sharing best practices and for capability enhancement of our bilateral partners within ASEAN and beyond. Training in Indian naval training establishments, in fact all military establishments, which has been ongoing since 1950. Capacity building through sale or transfer or through lines of credit of platforms and weapons to friendly nations within ASEAN. Transfer of technology in specific cases as requested by certain countries, and depending on legalities, well, if they are permitted, we do that as well. But the most important and a silent element of defense and security cooperation, which is more civil than naval, is hydrographic cooperation, in which India owns expertise, which is even being respected by the UK Hydrographic Office, which used to be the Admiralty, which used to be the sole custodian of all navigational charts and their surveys all over the world. So we do this repeatedly with Indonesia and many other countries. And this is another area which can be looked at by countries. Thank you.
Thank you for that, and thanks for that, Admiral, and thanks to all the presenters for four very illuminating presentations. We have about 10 to 12 minutes left in the session, so I want to I have many questions of my own, but I think we can open it up as quickly as possible to all of you. So maybe we can take two or three different questions from people in the audience, and then we'll go back. If you can please keep your questions or comments very short, and direct them, if possible, to one or more people. So, gentlemen in the back, and then...
Yeah, my question is to Admiral Singh.
Sir,
Dr. Sarjeet today here. The way you pointed out about South China dispute, but still China is not serious about any claim of any other country, whether it's an international court is also decided, but they don't care for any even court decision. So how we can claim that we can deterrent for them?
I think up front here we had. If you just wait for the microphone and also introduce yourself.
Yes, Anisha, I have a question for both the non-Indian speakers, the Philippines and Singapore. What does ASEAN really expect in terms of security and defense from India? Thank you.
And, next to
my name is Inoue of Japanese Embassy in Delhi, and I was encouraged by some of the positive references by some speakers about Japan's engagement in the region, especially on the maritime capacity building, such as and also there was some reference about the potential of Japan-India collaboration in that part of the region, and such as on maritime domain awareness and so on. So my question, or rather than it's like a request, but is if any of the speakers could elaborate some possibilities of Japan, India collaborating in Southeast Asia in the field of security and defense. Thank you.
And can we see one more?
Thank you.
My name is Parthak. I work in infrastructure. On the Belt and Road, especially since the Japanese colleague is here, it appears that it's a cat and mouse game between Japan and India on one side and China and Pakistan on the other. Over the next 10, 15 years, who do you think will win?
And then one more question.
I'm from IDSA. If one of the speakers could kindly tell us this, if there is a scope for cooperation. Somebody spoke about Japan, what about a trilateral cooperation between Japan, India, and Vietnam?
Yeah, Vietnam?
Yeah.
Is that what you said?
Yeah.
We'll take a few of these questions one at a time. Maybe Rommel, you get a microphone. Rommel, if you could take the question maybe about what exactly India can do.
There are government perspectives, but I would like to articulate a more scholarly perspective on this. I think what ASEAN expects from India is in terms of information sharing when it comes to intelligence collection in the maritime domain. Like, for example, we know that the major powers already have prior information about China's activities in the Seven Reefs that they transformed into an island. But the Philippine government does not have any capability for early detection. But we know that India has that kind of intelligence information already. So we want some sort of intelligence sharing when, like that. And many other things. Like for example, we want India to play a more constructive role in patrolling the area. France is doing it, but not, why not India? Japan-India security partnership, it's possible, but your problem is China. China does not want extra regional powers in the area. But I think you should create pressure, you know, the concept of powers. You know, you have to pressure China to behave good. If China cannot agree to the code of conduct, there must be a pressure for China to behave more responsibly.
if I may ask a follow-up question, I sensed a small contradiction in your presentation. On the one hand, you're talking about how there's been a paradigm shift under the Duterte government with China. There's been an influx of Chinese investment that China and the Philippines have been able to set aside their problems. On the other hand, you described quite articulately the sort of fait accompli that China has been doing the island building. You did mention that there has been air defenses now. I mean, you have seen a militarization of some of these artificial islands as well. And then again, on the one hand, you said, you know, it should be provocation of China because by extra-regional powers, but then on the other hand, maybe extra-regional powers should be there to pressure China. It's also hard for, say, a country like India to take a position if the Philippines itself is not pursuing what. So how do you square that contradiction?
Yeah, you have to pay attention to long-term and short-term strategic objectives of the current government. The current government only has 6 years. And in these 6 years, the current government wants to get the best from China. And let the next administration. Let's get the money first. Let's get the islands later.
Darshana, if you want to take
a
question.
Yeah,
thank you.
On Japan, I think the two questions on Japan are quite interrelated in terms of what India and Japan can do in Southeast Asia. The India-Japan-Vietnam, I think, idea is, I don't know if it's going to take off, but it's definitely something that I guess this government could consider. I mean, we don't even have a bilateral exercise with Vietnam, standalone. So there is scope to do a lot more, just like I was saying in your presentation, that there's a lot been done, but there's a lot that is yet to be done that hasn't even been considered. So maybe trilateral exercise, and trilateral format is something that this government is open to and is exploring, as you can see more and more in the maritime domain. And not specifically what India, how India and Japan can collaborate. I think I've also talked about infrastructure, you know, the infrastructure in maritime infrastructure in the region. So Japan is a really good partner for India to collaborate on infrastructure development in the region. So if India and Japan, Vietnam, India, Japan, Singapore, or you know, get into conversations on what is required or what is needed in ASEAN and Southeast Asia. So that is something
that can be provided in terms of constructive
development.
Anup, you had a few questions directed at you, but I want to add or supplement one. And specifically, is there a scope for greater India-Japan cooperation in the Andaman and Nicobar Islands?
I'm glad you asked that question. In fact, I missed out in my presentation. When I spoke of the Andaman and Nicobar Islands and said that if that compass is shifted to that place, that's Indian territory, part of India, rather than the mainland, see where it goes. And that's, people would say, oh my God, power projection from a standoff range. But actually, you have to remember that it's not just Armenia, it's part of the entire nation's efforts, including defense forces which are there. Now, Andaman Nicobar Islands, first of all, were not developed neither for tourism nor for defense forces. And a huge interruption took place in 2004 because of the tsunami. Now we are restored all, and we are wanting to develop the Andaman Nicobar Islands. And there's a great opportunity for Japan, which we've mentioned recently to the Japanese, and they have offered a few facilities, a few areas of partnership, where they'll build civil infrastructure, where we ourselves are putting up a cable between Singapore and Chennai to finally improve connectivity and communications. And I feel that there should be a large number of airfields, not just one full-fledged airfields, but with dual use. And similarly, a port somewhere in the south. That is what. And for, so far as Judea South's question is concerned, that's exactly what I said. You're saying, how can India be doing deterrent patrols when we won't go there, or we are not actually posturing? I said exactly that we are not there for deterrent patrols. I said, one picture of that nature appeared with a caption, finally, India postures with a deterrent patrol in the South China Sea, which is not true. Your other part of your question was about how do we, what you meant was how do we discipline China insofar as complying with the PCA ruling, etc. is concerned. But the rest of the world, since the PCA ruling, has been behaving like an ostrich, head in the sand. And China is laughing its way to grabbing more and more of territory in the oceans. So very little can be done unless the DOC followed by the COC can actually be implemented in the ASEAN.
Colin, do you want to take the question on maritime
awareness
in some way, as well as possibly the question on what's, I mean, I thought you were outlining a few specific
first of all, allow me to say that we have to congratulate ourselves throughout up to this part of the discussion. We talk about Donald Trump.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Which I think that is a rather pertinent question, because I guess we have to look further ahead. In the next 4 years, even possibly 8 years, we are likely going to see a recession of the US from this region, notwithstanding the existing state of all the verbal commitments and all that, but we need to see the real concrete action. There's uncertainty, and that is where middle powers as well as the other regional major players have to step in. In this case, India, Japan, we saw that in the case of Japan, he stepped in. Prime Minister Abe stepped in into Philippines with a visit to Davao. And I think there's a real intention to try to arrest the uncertainty in a sense. The issue here is that we have more than just Japan coming in. We have India coming in, we have even Australia coming in. The issue here is not just about between India and Japan, I would say. I think it is a coordinating effort between the other dialogue partners. If not including China, we're talking about India, Australia, Japan coming together with the aim of not duplicating efforts when it comes to capacity building. So in this sense, what I will put forth is maritime domain awareness, because I see certain convergences here between India and Japan. Whereas Japan is able to provide the hardware, I think there's one aspect that India can come in, which is through providing the IT aspect to try to create a network. I think ultimately, it's not just about providing those assets for maritime domain awareness, like patrol aircraft and all that, like the TC-90s that you provide to the Philippines. Also to try to have those info sharing nodes across the region that I believe India and Japan can come together to coordinate efforts and to harmonize those efforts for building this sort of capacity. I think this is something that we need. I'm not even talking about provision of patrol vessels in a very ambitious way, because this is going to be encumbered with a lot of political baggage, as well as certain concerns by some countries as to whether you provide patrol vessels or warships or even high-powered naval assets is going to create some cause of concern. As when you look at, I mean, I'm trying to be realistic and pragmatic here at the Southeast Asian. End of the day, we like help, but we are also concerned about whether or not the help that we are trying to get will ruffle the feathers of somebody and then create some, tension in the process. So I think we need to be quite quite deliberate. In terms of not just MDA, I'm trying to put forth here some areas where India and Japan could come in. Is one area will be submarine safety. Not sharing information of submarine movement, but submarine safety, for example, as well as Coast Guard capacity building. I think this is also ties in very well with Japan's existing constraints when it comes to politics and domestic as well. So I think what is problematic here is that if you talk about direct policing by extra-regional power, I think that could become an issue for other countries. But what course and training exercises are actually quite subtle. So I think this one is still quite manageable. Thank you.
Thank you. We're out of time for this session. Please join me in thanking our panelists.